I always remember a story Umberto talks about a lot of how when he was a little kid, you know, there's an enormous river in front of the village where he lives in the forest, and one day it just became absolutely riven with black oil. When you see the river on fire that your people have depended on for 1,000 years because of oil contamination, you see your life and your future go up in flames.
What some environmentalists call the world's worst oil-related disaster.
My name is Steven Donziger. I was there in Ecuador when indigenous groups and Amazon communities were fighting Chevron in an epic battle for justice. My first trip to Ecuador was in April of 1993. I went down with some lawyers and scientists to investigate reports that Texaco had dumped literally billions of gallons of toxic oil waste into the pristine Amazon rainforest where indigenous groups live. No one really knew what would happen as a result of the trip, but one thing that did happen is those who went on it all committed to trying to do something to address the problem and to help the people and to hold Texaco, now Chevron, accountable for what looked like a massive human rights problem that was done deliberately. On my first trip, I was shocked by what we found. I expected to see pollution. I was shocked by the extent of it. Massive pools of oil, literally thousands of them all over the rainforest. The oil was on their clothes, it was in the air they breathed, it was in the food they ate, it was in the water that they drank. It was an apocalyptic nightmare. When you drill an oil well, you go thousands of feet underground, and all this rock and heavy metals and man-made chemicals that cause cancer come up out of the ground with the oil, and you have to put it somewhere, and they just put it in unlined pits in the jungle. In many of the pits, they built pipes on the sides to take the overflow into the nearby rivers and streams where people were using for their drinking water without telling the people that they were doing this.
Texaco utilizó la tecnología más barata con tal de tener mayores ganancias como recursos económicos, pero a cambio del mayor efecto ambiental y el mayor efecto en la salud de la gente.
I saw things that were unbelievably horrid.
De 20 niños que nacen, a 15, 16 niños les da esto.
People living in abject poverty because they couldn't escape the contamination.
Ahora es con mi hija, que tan guambra es mi hija y que tenga esa enfermedad como es el cáncer.
There are people there that are sick. It's a very poor region. There's absolutely no evidence that there's an increase in cancer rate.
And once you see it, and this was certainly true for me, you can't really turn your back on it. The trip changed my life. Out of that trip, we talked to people who wanted legal representation. These are all unique cultures. The Siona, the Quechua, the Kofan, the Sequoia, the Waurani all have their own languages and their own villages. Some are more farming oriented, others are more hunting, but all of them were 100% dependent on the forest for their survival. But once the oil came and poisoned this delicate ecosystem, they could no longer rely on their traditional sources of food and water. During the first 10 years of the case, we were fighting to have a jury trial in the United States. Texaco and Chevron did not want that. They were petrified of a jury. They were desperate to shift the case back to Ecuador, where they would continue with their impunity. The case ended up getting shifted to Ecuador. On the very first day of the trial, in October of 2003, in Ecuador, after Chevron had agreed to accept jurisdiction there, literally the first thing they did was challenge jurisdiction. They accepted jurisdiction in the United States to get it to Ecuador. Then we got there and they're like, oh, you don't have jurisdiction over us. And that began a years and years of completely bad faith, in my mind, unethical litigation tactics. Chevron's trial strategy was to sabotage the trial.
Nosotros no manipulamos. Nosotros fuimos los que pedimos venir aquí al Ecuador a ser
juzgado. Esto es lo que hay en el Oriente. Yo les invito a ver. Yo les invito a ver esto.
Chevron did not want any litigation on the merits of the claims of the Ecuadorians. They wanted to avoid that at all costs. They paid one of their employees, Diego Borja, to try to entrap a judge in a bribery scandal. He taped it through a pen.
Yeah.
We should
have
accepted.
This is all the Chevron Texaco.
You've read all of this?
Ya leído todo usted.
Poco, no mucho.
They were constantly filing dozens and dozens of trial motions in like a very short period of time, like an hour, to stop the court from functioning properly.
Eso es abogado corrupto de Texaco.
Señor, usted va a responder por sus palabras.
Yo estoy respondiendo, señor. Usted es un abogado corrupto.
Chevron would then file more motions to recuse the judge from the case. And that motion would then go to another judge, and it would delay the trial for 6 months.
Part of Texaco's strategy is to bankrupt us.
So Chevron has gone out of its way to avoid talking about the real issue, which is that it committed environmental crimes in Ecuador that have devastated indigenous groups, devastated farming communities, poisoned this incredibly important ecosystem that's critical to the survival of the planet for all of us. They don't want to talk about that. Why? Because it will undermine their business model. Chevron and other fossil fuel companies like to go into areas, take out the oil, get all the profits they can, and leave behind massive pollution that the public or the area communities have to pay. They report these enormous profits, but we, meaning the people, are actually subsidizing them because we're paying the cost for their pollution while they get the profits. So the case in Ecuador ended on February 14th, 2011, with a resounding victory for the affected communities. But up to this point, even though the people in Ecuador won the case, they've yet to receive the first dollar of their judgment.
Vimos la dramática presentación ahí, en que todo el mundo ya asumió que ese material que salía era petróleo y tenía la marca Texaco. Yo no observé ninguna marca.
Chevron knows if the people of Ecuador who've won this judgment are able to collect it, the floodgates will open and there will be potentially $1 trillion+ of liability, because what they did in Ecuador, they've done in dozens of countries around the world.
There are environmental problems in the region. We're not denying that.
Todo esto es petróleo.
Mira.
But those environmental problems are the responsibility of the Ecuadorian state. We did our part. Texaco did its part.
For someone to say that we just pushed dirt on the spits, it's absolutely true, untrue.
They basically have concluded that it's cheaper to pay hundreds of lawyers to fight this than to pay the people they harmed. Because once that happens once, the chances of it happening dozens more times increase dramatically, and their whole business model gets destroyed. It is a business model based on privatizing profits and socializing costs to the most vulnerable people on the planet. This case is about challenging that, ending it, holding it accountable. Which is why they are spending massive sums of money to try to destroy my life and hold me up as some sort of scalp that they can put on the walls of their homes like hunters put a moose head up. That's really what they want out of me. I am a human rights lawyer detained in the United States of America on bogus charges to help a U.S. company evade a $10 billion environmental liability owed to the most vulnerable indigenous groups in the Amazon. So what's the point of this other than to punish me for my successful human rights advocacy for the people of Ecuador? Their entire strategy now is to sue anyone who wants to help the case, including the lawyers, including me. Come back, 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 come back You know, I think there's a larger lesson to be learned from this experience. If we let the fossil fuel industry continue along its path, we will no longer have a planet. And, you know, you can look at this as, oh, there's this pollution and they sued and there's all this litigation. Or you can look at it as the first step of a new way of thinking. The idea that you can leverage resources such that communities understand that they have the power to form alliances around the world to hold the perpetrators of these environmental crimes and human rights violations fully accountable, such that they stop doing it. We will have a better world. And like, it's important not to get distracted by what's happening to any one individual, in this case me, because I'm in a difficult situation. It's important to understand that and to help me and to protect me and others like me. But we cannot preserve our planet for our children, for our grandchildren, for future generations unless this work is done.